Hi, my name is Jan Ruge, and welcome to my presentation on Frankenstein, advanced wireless fuzzing to exploit new Bluetooth escalation targets. First of all, why do we want to have a look at radio protocols? Well, by their nature, they are a huge attack surface, as any nearby person can try to interact with them. In this research, we mainly focus on Bluetooth firmwares, because Bluetooth is a very common radio protocol that is implemented in most mobile phones nowadays. And in addition, as soon as you have Bluetooth enabled on your device, and any nearby person can attack can connect to you by just knowing your Bluetooth address. And in addition, there are some lower layer protocols that are even terminated in the firmware and normally hidden to the user. And we wanted to have a look at this. So in our research, we are using emulation. The reason for this is, well, reverse engineering is hard, especially on embedded devices where even debugging can be quite hard. And normally you would face such a problem with an unknown firmware that you run static analysis, so you have a look at the code. But the problem here is that for our example, we have 300 functions that are somehow related to packet receptions, and we actually do not really know how those functions are invoked. We don't know the context of those functions, which functions are relevant. So even if you can have a look at each individual function in detail, you are missing the overall bigger picture, how the whole firmware is working, how the components are interacting with each other. Furthermore, if you just simply run the code and emulate it, you can narrow down the code of interest, because you only have to focus on the code that is actually executed, and therefore you can reduce the amount of code that has to be analyzed. So first of all, high-level overview what we try to do here. Here on the right, we have our Bluetooth development board that we are using, and this development board has two interfaces, essentially, one for the Bluetooth protocol, a radio interface, and a serial interface to the operating system. What we then try to do is to take a snapshot of the running firmware, send it to the host, and run our emulation there. The serial interface we are replacing with a pseudo terminal interface, and the radio interface is basically implemented by using fake I/O registers. Therefore, we can attach the emulated firmware to a host operating system, to the Bluetooth stack, and pass wireless frames into the emulated firmware and see how the whole system with the Bluetooth stack and the firmware is behaving with arbitrary packets. The way that we took our snapshot is, we first of all implemented our own hooking mechanism that is used to call our code prior any arbitrary function. And we use the code here on the right to actually perform or to extract a memory snapshot. First of all, we save all the registers to the stack, save the stack pointer to a known location, and then we run our subroutine to extract the memory to the host. This memory image contains all the regions, for example, the RAM, the memory mapped IOs, all the hardware registers, etc. And then on the host, what we can do is we can just jump to the continue label that will then restore the stack pointer again, restore the registers, and continue execution where we have left off. So essentially, we can use this method to extract a memory snapshot prior to any arbitrary function and continue the execution on our on our host system. As I mentioned before, we have to perform some modifications to the firmware. For example, if you simply execute the firmware, you won't get any output because, well, the firmware has no debug statements built into it. So we have to compensate for that and also compensate for the missing hardware. So we have to write code, and the language that we are choosing is C, in comparison to, for example, Unicorn that is mostly used with Python. We are using C here because it's the same language as the firmware is implemented in. So we using the same level of abstraction. In addition, we also had a whole list of all the symbols. And we can then link our C code against the symbols in the firmware. So we can call arbitrary functions within the firmware image. We can access global variables. We can dereference pointers as you would normally do in C. What we then do is we combine our compiled C code and our memory image to an ELF file. And this ELF file then describes the memory layout, what is the same as in the firmware, and also contains an additional page where our code is used for the emulation. On entry, we then start our own C code, perform some modifications to the code in the firmware. For example, we are installing hooks, overwriting functions, etc. And if we're done with that, we then call the continue function in order to restore the registers and continue execution. The resulting ELF file can then be executed using plain QEMARM that doesn't require any further modifications. And there you go, you have a running firmware. This is a snapshot or a screenshot how it looks in practice. So as you can see, we have added lots of debug messages. Essentially, we set a print a debug statement for every function that somehow seemed interesting during our static analysis. And we print a debug message for those functions, if they are called, with the link register, so we know where we come from, with the arguments, and even the return value. Furthermore, we have added some additional functionality, like in this case, for example, a heap sanitizer that performs checks on the integrity on the heap. And in this case, it has actually triggered an aborted execution. And as you can see here in the debug logs now, we have here a memory allocation of hex 109 bytes. And later we have a memcopy into this buffer with hex 645 bytes. So this is obviously a heap buffer overflow, and this is detected by our heap sanitizer. The nice thing here is that the heap sanitizer detects this memory corruption long before it would normally crash on the firmware. In addition, we are getting directly pinpointed to the location in the code where the memory corruption took place. So what's going on here? Well, this was an actual bug in the Broadcom Bluetooth firmware. It is a heap corruption that occurs during or can occur during device inquiry, and it affects Broadcom Bluetooth controllers manufactured from roughly 2010 up until 2018, and we have implemented a full remote code execution exploit for this. To give you an idea, Broadcom Bluetooth controllers are used in Samsung devices and Apple devices. And we are talking here about 8 years of production at minimum. So that could be easily a couple of 100 million devices that are affected. The bug itself is also quite interesting because it's located in two separate components of the firmware. On the right, we have a diagram. So on top, the blue part is the real-time operating system that is based on ThreadX. And the memory corruption is actually taking place here in the link manager. This is a memcopy I showed you. There's also a different component, the Bluetooth core scheduler, what is responsible for the time critical task in the Bluetooth protocol. And here is an additional bug because as I tried to extract the packet length from the payload header that can be seen here below, they also include the reserve for future use field into the packet length that is ignored by the hardware, but not in the software. Normally, this field should be set to zero, but if an attacker sets a single bit to one, the hardware can normally process a packet, but in the software, we will trigger a memory corruption. So what most people do if they want to fuzz wireless firmwares is they have a look at a single handler, call this handler over and over again, and try to produce a crash. However, in this case, you really need the interaction between all the different components of the firmware in order to observe this crash. So therefore, you really need a full emulation of the whole firmware in order to discover such vulnerabilities. So lastly, our outcome and conclusion. First of all, large-scale firmware emulation is possible. So you are not restricted in general to a single handler. You can really emulate the whole operating system and other components of the firmware. The approach that we have used has some advantages, for example, especially in comparison to Unicorn. First of all, we are using C, so we have the same layer as of abstraction as I said before, and this in general leads to more readable code as we don't have to use several API calls, for example, to dereference a pointer, what is quite common if you want to iterate over a linked list. And this, yeah, leads to more readable code. In addition, as we can do not need any API calls, we are a little bit more performant. So we have re-implemented the heap sanitizer in Unicorn, and we could prove that our approach in this particular case was around about one order of magnitude faster. In addition, the same code base for the emulator can also be used for patching devices. So for example, you can directly, or we have a different, a modified version of the compiling process to write patches. And you can use it, for example, to run the heap sanitizer on the device or to modify the firmware to perform fuzzing of different devices. And using this approach, we actually found an additional bug, what was a zero-click remote code execution in Android. So this is also a viable approach. There are also some disadvantages. Well, mainly, firmware emulation is still a tedious process. It requires a lot of time. You have to really read a lot of code. But in the end, if it's working, you get really good insights on how the firmware is working. Finally, I want to say our code is already online, so you might want to have a look at github.com/simolab/frankenstein. And this was it from my side. I would thank you for your attention and hand over to the next talk. Bye.